Hey everyone, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. What's smaller than a fingernail but worth billions? The answer, semiconductor chips. Let's talk about the IP, intellectual property, and patents surrounding this exciting industry. Before we do though, this episode is brought to you by our very own subscription service, Semiconductor Insider, where you can get access to all of our research.
That includes the extensive research notes for this video. But on Semi Insider, we also discuss our portfolio, stocks we're buying and selling, and most importantly, why, aka our research process. Join Semiconductor Insider right now. It's just 10 bucks a month. Link to it here in the video or in the description below.
We're going to be focusing on these three key points. IP and patents are foundational to chips and therefore the modern economy overall. Companies with great IP and how they make money. And third, we'll talk about IP and patents are best when they're vertically integrated.
Let's first define a couple of terms before we get into this. Intellectual property, or IP, is like a blueprint for a specific piece of technology. It could be an engineering design, a manufacturing process. It could even just be something as simple as a trade secret, something that a company wants to prevent its competitors from finding out about. A patent, on the other hand, is a type of legal protection for IP. Companies spend lots of money every year developing IP in general because it gives them some sort of competitive edge and also can generate a lot of revenue for them as well.
Think of semiconductor IP as the building blocks, the Legos, if you will, of all of our electronics. Smartphones, laptops, cars, everything runs on semiconductors that are built with this IP. In this slide provided by Synopsys, you can see that EDA and IP make up about $21 billion of the overall industry, a very small portion of the semiconductor industry. However, IP is a foundational part of the semiconductor industry. Here's our semi-industry flow, IP and patents up there in the top right. We estimate that IP and patent sales will make up about $7 billion in 2025.
And just an important note on this, that is the revenue that companies specifically call out as being IP and patent revenue in 2025. There's a lot of companies that have IP and patents and make money off of it, but most of them don't explicitly say, hey, this is the revenue line item that was specifically from an IP or patent sale. So why exactly would a company spend so much time developing a portfolio of IP?
Well, instead of reinventing the wheel, so to speak, a company can license pre-made IP blocks from another business and save time and money. And if the company's own IP is really hot, they can license it to other companies for a hefty fee.
We discussed this a little bit in our last video on EDA software. You can think of maybe a more traditional engineering or architectural team building a high-rise. Rather than designing by hand every single room and every single feature in that high-rise, an engineering team or architecture team might just take a pre-made design of a room or of an apartment or of an office space and repeat that design over and over again. It would dramatically accelerate the time to getting that building, the design, finished up. Something very similar happens with IP and patents. Rather than designing every single individual piece of a chip in-house every single time, a company might just simply use the IP from another company, pay them a fee, and that might just make good financial sense for them to save that time and effort.
An IP or patents company makes money by monetizing the IP in two different ways, licensing and royalties. Licensing is when a lump sum or ongoing payment allows a customer to design the IP into their own systems or device. Second option, royalties, that's when an IP company earns a small cut of every sale of a chip or a product sold that's utilizing its IP.
The competitive advantages a company may be able to develop in this IP portfolio really is highly variable. It depends on a lot of different factors. To help you get an idea of what makes for a really, really high competitive barrier to entry, or as we like to call it, a fast car or a fastest car in the semiconductor market, let's take a look at the heavy hitters in the semiconductor IP space. here's a look at those companies that explicitly call out revenue from IP licensing or royalties. The heaviest hitter in this market in semiconductor IP is, of course, Arm Holdings. That's the company that companies like Apple, Qualcomm, and others tap into to design their mobile processor chips. Arm is an absolute giant in this market.
The second company that we'll call out is Synopsys. Again, if you haven't seen that video on EDA that we did recently, we'll link it right here. Synopsys is a big player in electronic design automation, but they also have a massive library of IP.
Some other companies on this list, Qualcomm, you may have seen our other videos. We own shares of Qualcomm. Another important player in this space is Rhombus. Rhombus has been making waves in recent years for their high-speed memory and other memory interface chips and IP, as well as some security IP that they license out to chip designers. The other one that we'll call out here is Universal Display. That's another one that we have in our small cap basket portfolio.
Universal Display is a leader in OLED technology, or organic light emitting diode technology. That's the displays that you see in your TVs, possibly, definitely most of your high-end laptops and some of your tablets. The biggest market for OLED technology is in high-end smartphones. If you have the newest Apple iPhone, you probably have an OLED screen, and many other smartphone makers use this technology. If you want an expanded look into all of those companies we just mentioned, you can find that in our show notes, and you can get those show notes available with our Semiconductor Insider membership. You have access to that on Ko-fi, link in the video description below. We truly believe that investing in IP is best when that IP is a vertically integrated business. We have a couple of examples of that right here.
Yeah, let's start with Broadcom and Marvell. You've heard us talking about these two businesses extensively for the last few years. But especially in this last year, I think the entire investing community really started to get familiar with the power of Broadcom and Marvell. Both of these companies, historically fabless semiconductor designers. So you would think these are companies that just simply utilize IP to design a chip, and then they sell those chips after they've been manufactured by a partner like Taiwan Semi Manufacturing. They sell those chips off to a data center company or a mobile phone company, laptop company, et cetera. The beauty of these two businesses, though, is they actually have their own IP, and they've been finding new ways to license that IP out to companies like, in Broadcom's case, Google. Google's TPU, or Tensor Processing Unit, used in Google Search and Google Cloud, is largely thanks to the IP that Broadcom has and licenses out to Google's engineering teams. So Broadcom and Marvell, vertically integrated on the right-hand side of our semiconductor flowchart. Let's next look at a very different kind of company, Pure Storage.
When you think about Pure Storage, you may think of it only as a tech equipment and device company. They design and sell storage or memory servers. However, Pure Storage has begun to vertically integrate. It's pretty well known that they have extensive software that pairs with their devices, but Pure Storage has also developed IP for memory systems that they just announced. They did this announcement in partnership with memory manufacturer Kioxia that they will be licensing that IP out to a certain hyperscaler. This could be a key advantage for Pure Storage in the storage server market, where they compete with companies like Dell, HPE, and Supermicro Computer.
Okay, and let's look at one more vertically integrated IP company, none other than NVIDIA. A lot has been said about NVIDIA's competitive advantage in the AI training and AI inference market, but let's break this down here. The key to NVIDIA's success is they have vertically integrated, and they've vertically integrated in both directions. Of course, they've been getting increasingly into software and software libraries that companies need to operate these AI systems, but also moving further up the supply chain to IP and patents. NVIDIA has become a very, very powerful technologist that licenses out lots of IP and earns lots of royalties on all sorts of data center devices. One example of a company that might purchase a license and maybe even pay royalties to NVIDIA would be a company like Vertiv, which we've covered a number of times here on Semi Insider and here on our YouTube channel, and recommended it as a top pick at certain times in the recent past.
This quote is taken from Vertiv's 10K in 2023. It says they integrate licensed third-party technology and IP into certain aspects of their products. Who might that be? NVIDIA.
Yeah, that's right. A lot of investors looking for companies that develop semiconductor cooling and data center cooling systems. And of course, with NVIDIA Blackwell coming out, a lot of talk has been surrounding the fact that these things gobble up lots of power and therefore put off a lot of heat. And heat absolutely destroys performance. So those chips need to be cooled down. And Vertiv is one of the many companies developing these data center cooling systems. But in order to engineer that system, a company like Vertiv would need to license the technology first from NVIDIA. NVIDIA is not going to just open source that Blackwell system and allow just anyone to make money off of it. They're going to get a cut of that design, including from a company like Vertiv.
We have talked about this subject specifically over on Semi Insider. Of course, you can access that via a membership and get all the nitty-gritty details over there on Discord. As technology evolves, the demand for new and better IP is only going to continue to grow. Companies with strong IP portfolios and those that are vertically integrated are well positioned to lead the charge into innovation.
That's why we're big fans of semiconductor companies that don't just specialize only in the IP library itself, but vertically integrate that across the whole supply chain. Stay tuned for more videos. We'll be discussing this topic in more detail as 2025 progresses, including earnings season. We'll have more to say about this, especially when NVIDIA, Broadcom, and Pure Storage report in the coming months.
Thanks everybody for watching this episode of Chipstock Investor. Make sure you sub to the channel, like our video, please, and share with your friends. We'll see you again soon at Chipstock Investor. We've talked about this.
Get out of here, dog.
Rhea wants to make a cameo.